actually a learning experience to listen to so many people in the last few days. And I'll try if I can situate what I'm going to talk to you today in the larger context. And I would appreciate if you would link what questions you had earlier with what I'm going to present. And then I think the discussion would be much more meaningful than just me throwing data at you. So I'll go through a couple of studies, which I hope to help in raising some questions or maybe answering them. I'm not sure anymore. This work was done before the election, so you have to. This will be quite interesting to me as well. So I would start with deprivation, which lots of speakers have talked about. I'll only talk about a specific aspect of deprivation, and then I'll go to look at other reasons of its persistence. Could there be cultural, social, etc. reasons which would perpetuate it continuously or manifest itself in various forms? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly run through, hopefully within the limited time, talk about these four studies in the last 3 years. Four studies in the last 3 years. One is a study on poverty, with my co-authors. Other is a study of untouchability. It's a paper which is now accepted after 3 years and three rejections. Nobody wanted to touch the paper. It was an untouchability paper, so it became an untouchable. Then there's a paper on open education and links with untouchability, the dean. And there are two papers we can talk on. Perceptions of prejudice. So I'll run through some of this. So the first three studies use a data set which is quite interesting, and I also want to introduce the data set to you. It is called the India Human Development Survey. Originates in the Sociology Department of University of Medellin and is fielded in India by National Council of Applied Economic Research. It's a nationally representative multi-topic survey, and it's the only panel data available for now. There are other panels also of NCER and IIDS, but they are limited to certain states and small samples, but this is a pan-India panel data set, so it allows you to do some kind of research which other data sets doesn't allow you. So to assume you know what a panel data set is, it's a longitudinal data. Basically you do a survey, a sample survey, in particular households, and then you revisit the same households, unlike NSSO, which does a new sample each time. A new cross-sectional sample is done each time by NSSO. Unlike that, the panel, what it does is it does a sample and then revisits them, the same households, as many as they can. So you have a continuity and you can track progress of households. So there are two waves of this survey, one in 2004-05 and the second in 2011-12. Large samples, as you can see. So these study use this data set both as a panel as well as a cross-section. And about 41,000 and 42,000 sample sizes cross-sectionally, and the panel element is about 38,000 households, which is about 85% of the households were revisited. Carried out across all states and Indian territories, and it is a survey which collects information on various social, economic, demographic, cultural, behavioral indicators at individual, household, and village level. Things like income data for the first time, consumption expenditure data, asset, health, minor morbidity, major morbidity, education, youth questionnaire, intra-household decision making, networks. So it has both sociological, economic data which you can link, which is very difficult to do across other surveys. The data is freely downloadable from the website www.iisds.info, and now more than 9,000 users are using it, and now maybe 300 papers are published. It is more kind of popular in the West because of its ease of usage. You can download it in a minute, and the first table across tab can be generated within 5 minutes if you have Stata or So the data is also available in Excel, RAW, Stata, SPSS, and other formats for you to download. Okay, there are six schedules. I will not go into the details. A household schedule, education and health schedule, which is basically administered with an ever married woman, a youth schedule, a village FDG, FGD, a medical facility, public, private, primary, school facility, public, private. Learning tests are administered to children, reading, writing, and mathematics in English, Hindi, and their vernacular languages. The results from these are very shocking. I can share them with you. Anthropometric data on weight and height, etc. Okay, so the first study here, what I'm doing is basically comparing incidences of poverty. On the right hand side are incidences from NSSO, and on the left is from the data set I just talked about. You have rural poverty in red, urban poverty in green, and total poverty in pink or more, whatever that is. So what you see is the story which everyone talks about is that poverty is reduced substantially between 2004-5 and 11-2. And this is a cause of celebration, overall anywhere between 50% to percentage point reduction in poverty has happened. Rural, urban, and active. If we look at the same by social groups between these two time periods, this is what you see. The red bars show the poverty in the first period, that is 2005. And the green bars is 11-12. The brown bars show you the percentage point reduction in poverty. So first of all, you notice poverty incidences being high among Dalits, Adivasi Dalits, OBC, Muslims, then OBC, and then forward caste. Now this has come down over the 2 years, substantial reduction. But you can see the relative differences remain. So the tide has increased all the boats, but all the boats have risen, not relatively differently, but in the same manner. So, while you see that, you know, Adivasis have done very well, 24 percentage point reduction, Dalits also, and Muslims and OBC. Similarly, the differences remain, and the poverty are still high, 42% for Adivasis. Now, what this is a cross-sectional analysis. At one point of time, another point of time. Now, what the IIDS, because it's a panel, allows you to do is the following, which is, it tells you of the people who are poor in the round one, first round 2004, of all the poor, 64% escaped poverty in 2011. That's the blue bar. In rural areas, 71 in urban areas, and aggregate 64. However, at the same time, people who are not poor have fallen back into poverty. So we 16% in rural areas, 8% in urban areas, aggregating 14%. So when we see poverty reduction over a period of time, we see as a linear kind of a thing that it is slowly reduced and we're happy about it, fantastic. But we don't realize that at the same time when people are escaping poverty, there are people also falling back into poverty. Now what is the breakup of this? Before that, this is another way of looking at the same thing. This is the breakup of the rural and urban population in 2011-12. So in rural areas, 10% of the population is those who became poor, who fell into poverty in 11-12. Urban, it's 6. 15% of rural population continued to be poor across both rounds. Similarly, 9% in urban areas. And these are the new non-poor in rural and urban areas. That means 27 and 21% of population escaped poverty. And these are the ones who continue to be non-poor. Now the difference is, these are chronically poor. They continue to be poor while overall poverty is falling. What this gets missed out is, there's a core group of people who continue to be poor. And then another group of people who have just come out of poverty. Now that doesn't mean that once you come out of poverty, you stay out of poverty. If you look at longitudinal data in America from the 60s or in Europe in across countries, over 2-3 decades, you find that people are constantly coming out and going into poverty, which is called a hit rate. How many times you hit the poverty from below, how many times you hit the poverty line from above. And you can track households for generations, 3 generations, 4 generations, for such a long period that the original household members are no more there in the current period of time. And then you can Then you can, I try to identify what are the characteristics, social, economic, demographics of households who are transient poor. They are coming out of poverty, falling into poverty. And what is the core of people who never come out of poverty or, you know, are constantly in poverty. So the kind of policies which should address these two groups, transient poor and the chronic poor, it tends to ends up being different. However, our policy and approach towards poor is little bit like a homogeneous group. Now, if we break it by social groups, that's where the fun starts. And you see the rates of escapes are systematically lower and rates of falling into poverty systematically higher for the Adivasi, Dalit, OBC. So the disadvantage of this, so the churning, the transient poor, the you know, the people are escaping, falling back, there's a shock, there's a medical shock, health shock, or earning member dies, or suddenly you have to seek a loan for your daughter's marriage, or some you have to do some puja for your shroud for your deceased father. Those are shocks. There could be medical shocks, there could be environmental disaster, anything that suddenly push you back into poverty, and this is the vulnerable section which would more likely to fall back into poverty than escape. So this is something which highlights that. Now, is this historic deprivation which we are seeing? So the disadvantage continues, and you know, the tribals and Dalits and to some extent Muslims and obviously have been excluded, as so many speakers have talked about in the last 2 days, educationally, asset-wise, etc., etc. And what part of is it continuing exclusion and discrimination? So these two things get confounded, and it's difficult to separate that. So that's one point. This is the same by, unfortunately this has got truncated, it's Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Christian and others. This is the same, but you can see that the Christians, the Sikhs and the Christians have done much better than the Muslims and the Hindus. The Muslims actually have done slightly better than the Hindus in escaping, but they're slightly also higher in terms of falling back into poverty. This is the same thing by occupation types. So what we find is that if you have a salary, you're in business, you have some farmland, or you get remittance, the more people are then escaping poverty. Whereas if you're in the government, agriculture wages, non-agriculture wages, others, you are escaping, but you're also more vulnerable to fall back into poverty. Okay, so the question is, are we prematurely celebrating the aggregate reduction of poverty? Can a big shock now, we don't have data after demonetization. Hopefully NSS, IIDS-3 will be fielded next year in June. NSS round is about to come. We probably get to know the impact of demonetization on the unorganized and the sector and the self-employed people and others. So this figure may get even more disheartening. And so we need to also make a distinction between the chronically poor and the transient poor. So there is migration, there is some construction work, etc. You have some land and you're migrating and you're trying to pay for the private schooling of your children, the private medical expenses, etc. And so you're trying your best to have diversification of employment, farm, labor, etc., etc. But then a shock will, so there are the transient poor, but there is chronically poor poor who, so the transient poor may be caught by things like Manrega or PDS can help you, right? We see that SCST are the largest population which avails of Manrega. But what about the chronically poor? Do we need to, if you really need to get them out of poverty, my presumption is you need different kinds of policies. And why are Adivasi, Dalits and to some extent Muslims and OBC still lagging behind in the fact that there are escape rates but disproportionately higher in falling? So is it historic deprivation? How much of it is historic deprivation? How much of it is continuing exclusion and discrimination? So those, these are the questions. And I'd like to end your... Now the second study is where, this is again ISDS2, I was part of this survey. And I managed to sneak in a question, and my boss was very generous enough, she was very kind enough to let me ask this question. So every household we surveyed in India, we asked this question. Do any members of your household practice untouchability? Yes or no? If they said yes, okay. If they said no, a follow-up question was asked, which was, would there be a problem if someone who is from a scheduled caste enters your kitchen or shares your utensils? Yes or no? So this is a pan-India nationally representative survey. And this is the response rate which we got. 30% of rural India, 20% of urban India accepted that yes, they or someone in their family does practice untouchability. Now this is a face-to-face survey, which means the interviewer is asking the respondent the question, and you know, you have a social desirability going on, bias going on, that you want to be politically correct, etc. But and you may lie, or many people say, oh, we don't know, I don't want to answer the question, I don't understand the question. And then some say no, we don't. And then some say yes, we do. So this is more, this is very likely and is, as we will find out, an under representation of the actual extent of the practice. Now then the next question arises, who are the people who are practicing it, right? So we break them up, and so this is what we find, that from our sample, which is nationally representative, half of those we surveyed, Brahmins, of half of those we surveyed, 52% of Brahmin, 24 forward, 33 OBC, 15 SC and 22 ST households accepted that they practice untouchability. So we were very surprised as well. A, that why more of OBC practicing untouchability than 20 forward caste. So I would like to hear your responses. Who are these 15% SC who are practicing untouchability, and why are a substantial number of tribals practicing untouchability? So, and we had our own theorizations, and you know, they're open to critique and discussion. And we think that the new conflict that has emerged between the OBC and the SC for share, and that's why you see a lot of demand from OBC for reservation as well, leads to conflict and also a desire to, you know, reassert their status, which is supposedly higher than the SC. And in the whole scheme of Sanskritization, you know, you want to do and practice the rituals of which kind of mimic the practices of the Brahmins. So maybe that's there. Here, 15% of SC, of this, the 10% were those who said yes to the first part of the question. Does anyone in your family practice untouchability? And the last 5%, the other 5% were those who said no to the first question. No, nobody practices untouchability. But when you ask them, is it okay for SC to enter your kitchen or use your utensils, they say yes, it is not okay. So the first 10%, we think it could be difficult to interpret, because if you ask a scheduled caste person, do you practice untouchability, it is likely the person will say yes, because the onus of practice untouchability also lies in the scheduled caste person. Not to walk on a particular street, not to fetch water from this well, not to do this, not to do that. So he'll say, yes, I practice untouchability. We did not realize that this could be one way of the question being interpreted by the Dalits. So it is likely, that's, we are not sure. But 5% for sure said, no, it's not okay for a lower caste. So there's the sub caste, you know, the Valmikis or the Bhangis who may not get entry into the so-called slightly upper scheduled caste. So that is possible. And the STs, well, either they are mimicking the behavior, they are Hindus. 98% of these STs you see here are Hindus also. They report their religion being Hindu. So it's kind of evident. This is by religious groups. Surprising here being 23% of Sikhs and 18% of Muslims saying yes, we practice untouchability, and 35% Jains. Now, anyone, you know, can say why this is happening, and I'd love to hear your interpretation. Jains is a tricky category because it's a small sample, and secondly, they are vegetarians and they don't even eat things which grow under the ground, such as onion and garlic. So the question of anyone entering the kitchen is out of the question. Dalit, non-Dalit, Brahmin, or anything. So they are saying, no, nobody can enter that kitchen. Scheduled caste, of course, never. So that's a mixed bag. Okay, this is a map we made at district level. This is a district level map of the practice of untouchability. The dark reds you see are areas or regions where more than 50% of our sample, village level sample, PSU, practice untouchability. And as the gradation goes from red to, say, white, there's 10% reduction in each gradation. So you can see the concentration is mostly in the north. This is where we are, I think. We are here, and some in Assam. But one question I got asked in many places was, why is Maharashtra and Kerala so white? So I said, the Marathi, we had Ambedkar movement in Maharashtra, and Kerala there is communism, so either they don't practice it as much, or they know what is the correct answer to give. So we really don't know. These are self-reported responses. But this is an interesting graph. So there's an interesting story to this. So I had sent a small piece of this to Indian Express, and I thought they'll just publish it somewhere, and the editor had other ideas, and the next day she made a headline out of it. 30% of India practices untouchability. And I was like, I'm dead now. This is 2014. I'll be attacked and chopped on half or something by the, and I was scared. But that eventually led to a lot of discussion, online forums, etc. And eventually someone from South India, who must have seen this, went into the parliament, asked the question to the then Minister of Social Justice and Empowerment. What was his name? Sankala. Why is this? Can you explain this? What are you doing? Because the 2014 BJP manifesto, if you look at it, says explicitly that we work towards reducing malnutrition. So the ministry got to us and said that, look, this has come out, this is your study, can you give us a report? I said, the report is not ready, but we stand by these results. Here's a shorter 3-page note for you. Again, after 3 months, we gave me the report. Can you please send it? So it got lost apparently in the first. And then the minister goes on in the parliament and said, oh, the report is not published. So I was like, okay, great. Anyways, so that's a side story to this. And then we sent this paper to 3 international journals. They all refused to even review it. They said, we don't publish this kind of stuff. So there it goes. Anyways, the second study is with Dean. He's an economist from Princeton at Austin now. And we wanted to see, so Dean comes from this health, side. And he was completely, flummoxed, but why do we defecate in the open so much, Indians? I said, I think there is a notion of some purity pollution going on. And then we said, okay, let's see if we can test, or we can quantitatively test the hypothesis that the culture of caste and the notion of purity and pollution, does it support widespread and continuing open defecation? Okay, so let's test this. So our empirical strategy was to ask the question that are households that live in villages where more of their neighbors practice untouchability also more likely to defecate in the open? So you have a village where a lot of people practice untouchability, and in a village there are less people who practice untouchability. So the people in the former village, are they more likely to defecate in the open than people in the latter village where less people defecate in the open? And the situation in India, which to my mind hasn't changed much, is that 60% of all the people in the world who defecate in the open in 2015 lived in India. So we are the largest contributor to that figure. 50% of people in rural India defecate in the open, that's NFHS 15-16 results. And then Dean and Diane also did a survey in Rajasthan, Bihar, MP, UP called SQUAT, aptly named SQUAT, social, what is it called, sanitary quality utilization and trend, where they found that 40% of households with a working toilet, in those households, at least one member, if not everyone, still defecated in the open. So you have a toilet, but you are still defecating in the open. And they've recently done the same survey, gone back to the same household just before 2014 elections. And there's a lot of political story behind it, which I cannot reveal here. And they had to rename it, do it in a clandestine manner, and they found that this figure has gone up to 45. So the Swachh Bharat claims and all are, you know what they are. And when they presented it, they got a backlash from the ministry, and one guy in the ministry actually wrote an op-ed saying that, questioning the credibility of these academicians. They're from Princeton. Dean is an economist, Diane is a demographer. They were taught by Angus Deaton, who just won the Nobel Prize. And he's questioning their credibility. So you can imagine the shock of the ministry, but they had to counter them. And the only thing was, you're not ethnically credible. That's all they could counter. Okay, so now, if we say that poor people cannot build toilets, money is a problem. Here on the x-axis, we have log of monthly per capita expenditure or income. So from the left to the right, income is increasing. And on the y-axis, we have the percentage share of households practicing open defecation. And you see, as people's income increases, the share of open defecate, households defecating in the open goes down. But at every level, there is a difference. The blue solid line represents household that practices untouchability, and the green dashed line shows household that does not practice untouchability. So at every level of income, people practicing untouchability are also practicing more open defecation. So that's by income. Education. Change income is education, that is the highest level of adult education in the household. Any adult and their level of education. As education increases, share of people practicing defecation falls, but at each level of education, those practicing untouchability also practice more open defecation. So association, some kind of association is coming up. Then this is at the village level. On the x-axis, we have the village average practice of untouchability, percentage of households in the village practicing untouchability, and again open defecation. Now you control for anything, the share of the caste or the village composition of different castes and income and everything else. So each line represents the relationship between open defecation and village average levels of untouchability, controlling for something. But you find that as untouchability practice is increasing, open defecation is increasing. Don't bother with this. What we then try to do is, we try to find out what all this means for each state. Now, what we find in India, there's a puzzle, there's a dilemma. The rich states, like Gujarat, etc., Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, have similar levels of open defecation as poor states like UP and Bihar. But states in Northeast, which are also poor, do not show such high levels of open defecation. So there is a puzzle, what is going on. So in this table, we collapse each of the states down to one observation. And in the first column, we are just looking at the association between open defecation and the state average in the practice of untouchability. So average practice of untouchability in the state and open defecation. We find that differences across states in the practice of untouchability. So in each state, some states have high practice. Himachal is number 2, Uttarakhand is number 3, UP is number 1, practice of untouchability. So the practice varies across states. And also the share of people practicing open defecation varies across states. So this variation in untouchability, it alone explains 50% of the variation in the practice of open defecation. That's the first. Then you add literacy, it explains another 20%. And then you keep adding anything else, poverty, consumption, confidence in politics, narega, many things. it hardly increases. So the bulk of the change, the variation in the practice of open data regulation, 50% of the effect is explained by untouchability, and another 20% by education. So this is the paper which we found, where we found this relationship between. So what is happening is the notions of purity and pollution, which inform people about untouchability, are very similar and the same where when they why they practice untouchability. So I cannot have a toilet in my house because I have a temple in my house, and you know the toilet will emanate foul smell, etc., and my house will be spiritually polluted. This patriarchy involved. You ask a person, a male head of the household. He said, "Well, I'm an able-bodied man. I'll wake up. I'll walk. I'll defecate in the open. Only old people and cripples or differently abled use the toilet at home." So there's that notion of patriarchy coming. And there are other reasons as well. But this is, we found this to be the salient one. So the point is that when we think of untouchability as an independent variable, a cultural practice, the mindset which it represents overtly of purity and pollution, it can explain phenomena which at first glance seem puzzling. And you know, we have a sense, but how it happens and how we can prove it, you just have to try, and I think it's